to my lungs. You bring to life these dry bones. I know that you're alive. You call me one of your own. In my heart, you make. I'm coming alive. Good morning and welcome to church. We are Ealing Worthing and it's so good that you've been able to join us. So we're going to continue as we do every week at the moment. We're going to have an icebreaker. I'm going to give you a question and if you can pop your answers in chat and then we give you time to do that. So the question for today is, what's the first thing you generally do when you realise you have made a mistake? What's the first thing you generally do when you realise you've made a mistake? If you pop your answers on chat and we'll have a good look at them. Thank you.
Laying your majesty aside.
Thank you so much for all your comments on chat. It really is interesting, isn't it, how we all deal when we realise we've made a mistake, you know, how we deal with that. So really do appreciate all your comments. Thank you. So, hi and welcome to church. We're Ealing Worthing. My name's Kim. I'd like to say a big hello to May. May, hi. Hopefully we're going to see you in person next week. All the details of that are in the newsletter, which hopefully you've all received. And before we start our service, obviously want to say a very, very, very big congratulations and many best wishes to the new Mr. and Mrs. Steele. Rosemary and Jonathan, what a fantastic wedding. Thank you so much for inviting us all along. And obviously, I know a lot of people weren't able to come, but those of us who were, it was just fantastic. And you are such a gorgeous bride, and may I say, a very handsome groom as well. So that was just lovely, and thank you. Congratulations. Now, every week what we've been doing is we've been doing our Bible Mastermind of the Week. Our question this week for the Bible Mastermind of the Week was from Nehemiah 8 or maybe even Nehemiah 9. And the question was after 3 hours of confession and worship, what did they do? Now, your choices were prayed, A, B, celebrated, or C, ate. And this week, I'm not going to tell you who the winner is. I will do a little drum roll. But what I'm going to do, I'm actually going to put it on chat who the winner is. So very well done, Bible Master of the Week. You know who you are. We know who you are now. And we will be contacting you with any very serious biblical questions that we have. So very, very well done. Thank you. Okay, so as you can probably tell, we're very, very excited because having done our online services, which I'm sure you will agree, I just think have been absolutely fantastic. I think everyone that's been involved with the online services have just done such an amazing job. And big thank you to everyone that's been involved because, you know, it does take a lot to, you know, to sing in front of everyone and to film yourself at home like we used to and to do the reconnects. And Next Gen is just fantastic and everyone leading and speaking and obviously all the tech team behind, you know, just amazing, absolutely amazing that we went from not knowing really how to do that to, I think, getting as good as you could possibly be. So thank you to everyone that's been involved with that. But from next Sunday, we have a new venue and we are actually going to meet as a gathered church. You can still watch the service online, but a couple of things you really do need to take note of is that the fact that we are going to be at Chesswood Middle School, Chesswood Road, Worthing, and our service is going to start at 10 o'clock. You can arrive from 9:30 for tea and coffee, but our service will start at 10 o'clock. So even if you decide that you're going to be watching from home, which is absolutely fine, you do need to make sure that, you know, you're online chat from 9:30 and then, you know, watching the service from 10. Now, we sent all out the details of the guidance for this and, you know, best practices really in the newsletter. But what we'll do as well, we will attach the link to that document in the chat. So if you haven't had a chance to look at the newsletter, then obviously you'll be able to find all the information that you need there. We're so looking forward to seeing you. We do appreciate that some people may be hesitant and you might not come the first week. That's absolutely fine. You know, you know, we know that you're there. So, you know, and you're welcome anytime at all. So do look at that information. If you have any questions at all, do give us a ring during the week and we'll be sure to let you know. So we are looking at Nehemiah 8 and 9. And can I just say that you haven't got me reading it this week, which is probably just as well, but we do have the lovely Mr. and Mrs. Steele who are going to be reading those. So we look forward to them reading God's word later. So we're going to be looking at learning to not make the same mistakes. And what is interesting is that when the leaders prayed, they not only declared the mistakes they'd made, but they also declared what God had done and his character. So I'd like to open our service today in prayer along those same lines. So if we could pray. Father God, may your glorious name be praised. May it be exalted above all blessing and praise. You alone are God, making the skies, heavens and stars. You made the earth and the seas and everything in them. You preserve them all. We have sinned against you in thought, word and deed and ask you for your forgiveness, as you are a God of forgiveness, gracious and merciful. slow to become angry, and rich in unfailing love. You have never abandoned us and have done more for us in and through Jesus than we could ever hoped or imagined. Help us to keep you, Jesus, and the Holy Spirit the centre of all we think, say and do. In Jesus' name. Amen. So, we're going to go into a time of worship. We're going to have our next gen. We're going to have some giving. And then we're going to have our talk. And then I'll just come back at the end. So, over to worship.
Holy Spirit, Unless you come, will you meet me here again? 'Cause all I want is all you are. Will you meet me here again?
Why I sing your praise will ever be on my lips.
That's just lovely. Part of our worship is in our giving, that's often in the way of our prayers, our time, our thoughts for others, our deeds for others, and also financially when we give for God's kingdom. So every week we give an opportunity. This is our giving time, and the details for how you can give will come up on the screen in a moment. If you're a visitor, you know, you don't have to pay to come to church. It's not that at all. This is just part of our worship to God. So we're going to put on some music, get up out your seats, and let's get giving and dancing.
What can't you do, Jesus? Let's go!
Thank you. So what I'm going to do is just pray over our giving, if I may. Heavenly Father, I thank you so much, Lord, that you give us so much. And this is just our small opportunity to give you back just a portion of what you have already given to us. And I pray, Father, that you would just bless and multiply the finances that we've given, you know, through texting or through the bank, any way that we've done that, Lord, I just pray that you would just bless that and multiply it to your glory. And Father, I pray that you would just bless those that give of their time and their effort and their love and their heart for all of those things in your kingdom, Lord. And I just pray, Father, that you would just bless us all as we want to bless you. And I just ask that in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. So now we're going to our Next Gen, and Next Gen is the name for our team of children and young people. So let's see what they've got for us today. Is it Lego?
Good morning and welcome to Next Gen. My name's Chris. And this morning we are continuing with our series, Jeremiah, Pray,
no,
Plan,
no,
But...
No, sorry.
Okay. Good morning and welcome to Next Gen. This morning we are continuing with our series, Jeremiah, Pray, Plan...
No.
Okay. Nehemiah, Pray, Plan, Build. Sorry, I kept making the same mistake again and again, which is what we're talking about today. And the title of what we're talking about is Learning Not to Make the Same Mistakes from Nehemiah 8 and 9.
Good morning. This is our tin man. And he's starting to become slightly creased from making the same mistakes. The more mistakes he makes, the more creased he becomes. In Nehemiah 8 and 9, we see that Ezra reads out the teachings of Moses to the people once they've finished building the wall. The people hear about how their ancestors turned away from God, not just once, but a number of times, making the same mistakes. Our tinfoil man is marked by repeatedly doing wrong things. The people of Jerusalem heard and realized the mistakes that had been made, and they were sad. They wanted to make amends, and they confessed their sins. When we let Jesus into our lives, we, like the people of Jerusalem, become aware of the mistakes or the sin that we have in our lives. And so we can ask God to show us where we're going wrong, to point out the mistakes. When we're sorry for the wrong things we do, then these can be rolled out. Like our tinfoil man, our mistakes can be erased and moved to the past. Our memories are the reminder for us not to make the same mistakes. We can ask the Holy Spirit to continually keep us living the right way and doing the right thing. We can then be a witness to those around us that our mistakes don't have to hold us back.
Good morning. The craft today, we need to start off with a white piece of paper or card, and I want you to draw a cross on the front. Then you can decorate it however you like. I've actually gone for some rainbow colours. The three words I've written on the cross are to remind us about our focus this morning, which is learning from our mistakes. The first word I've used is acknowledgement, and that's recognising that we've made a mistake. And then repentance is the second word, and obviously that is asking for forgiveness and being sorry. And lastly, action, which is where we can involve God and pray and ask him to help us and guide us to learn from our mistake. In the middle, I've put a little arrow, and you just need to make a hole and use a split pin. And the idea is to point it down. It's a bit fiddly. And then when we have asked for forgiveness and we're sorry, then we can turn the arrow back to the top for the action, for the learning, for the growing, and the moving forward from our mistakes. As humans, we do make mistakes over and over. It's just one of those things that we do, and God will help us and guide us. Okay, let's pray with Sharon.
Thanks to Dawn for the craft. But before we pray, if there are any mistakes that come to mind from doing the craft, from listening to our teaching, then now is the time to actually stop the cycle and to stop repeating those same mistakes. So we'll pray. Lord, we thank you that our mistakes don't have to be repeated over and over. We thank you that knowing Jesus can keep us from turning away from God and making the same mistakes. Thank you that we can ask the Holy Spirit to show us where we need to change. Help us to realise the impact of our mistakes and to help us to understand that we need to stop. Help us to remember that the Holy Spirit can strengthen us to act and to make the changes that we need. We have a second chance to live a life that makes a difference and allows us to spend eternity with our Lord and Saviour. Amen. See you next week. Enjoy the rest of the service.
That's really great, Next Gen. Thank you so much. I just think we learned so much from your presentation, so thank you for that. And I hope you've all done your craft. And if you have, take a picture, post it on Flourish. That'd be really, really lovely to see. So we're going to move on to our talk in a moment. But first of all, we're going to have Nehemiah 8 and 9 read. And I really don't know how they've managed this, you know, being away on their honeymoon, and they filmed this and sent it to us. Such dedication from Mr. and Mrs. Steele. So we have Rosemary and Jonathan reading Nehemiah 8 and Nehemiah 9. And then Andrew's going to come and talk. So if I may, I'm just going to pray for Andrew, and then we'll go into hearing the reading. Heavenly Father, I just thank you so much for your word. I thank you, Lord, that it is so as a double-edged sword, that your word says that what is sent out never comes back void. You know, it always meets your purpose. Lord, I pray for ears to open and hearts to be ready to receive your word, Lord. Thank you that nothing is wasted. Nothing is wasted in our lives. Nothing is wasted from the word that we hear from you. So be with us, I pray, as we come before your throne and hear your word. And I pray that, Lord, that you just be with Andrew as he speaks. You know, he's taken the time this week to seek you and to bring your word to us. And I pray, Lord, that you would just anoint his words. I just ask that all in Jesus' name. Amen.
All the people came together as one in the square before the water gate. They told Ezra, the teacher of the law, to bring out the book of the law of Moses, which the Lord had commanded for Israel. So on the first day of the seventh month, Ezra the priest brought the law before the assembly, which was made up of men and women and all who were able to understand. He read it aloud from daybreak till noon as he faced the square before the water gate, in the presence of the men, women, and others who could understand. And all the people listened attentively to the book of the law. Ezra, the teacher of the law, stood on a high wooden platform built for the occasion. Beside him on his right stood Mattithiah, Shema, Ananiah, Uriah, Hilkiah, and Maaseiah, and on his left were Pedaiah, Mishael, Malkijah, Hashem, Hashbadanah, Zechariah, and Meshulam. Ezra opened the book. All the people could see him because he was standing above them. And as he opened it, the people all stood up. Ezra praised the Lord, the great God, and all the people lifted their hands and responded, Amen, Amen. Then they bowed down and worshipped the Lord with their faces to the ground. The Levites, Jeshua, Bani, Sherebiah, Jamin, Akub, Shabethiah, Hodiah, Maaseiah, Kelita, Azariah, Jozabad, Hanan, and Peliah, instructed the people of the law while the people were standing there. They read from the book of the law of God, making it clear and giving the meaning so that the people understood what was being read. Then Nehemiah the governor, Ezra the priest and teacher of the law, and the Levites who were instructing the people said to them all, This day is holy to the Lord your God. Do not mourn or weep. For all the people had been weeping as they listened to the words of the law. Nehemiah said, Go and enjoy choice food and sweet drinks and send some to those who have nothing prepared. This day is holy to our Lord. Do not grieve, for the joy of the Lord is your strength. The Levites calmed all the people, saying, Be still, for this is a holy day. Do not grieve. Then all the people went away to eat and drink, to send portions of food and to celebrate with great joy, because they now understood the words that had been made known to them. On the second day of the month, the heads of all the families, along with the priests and the Levites, gathered around Ezra the teacher to give attention to the words of the law. They found written in the law which the Lord had commanded through Moses, that the Israelites were to live in temporary shelters during the festival of the seventh month, and that they should proclaim this word and spread it throughout their towns and in Jerusalem. Go out into the hill country and bring back branches from olive and wild olive trees, and from myrtles, palms, and shade trees to make temporary shelters, as it is written. So the people went out and brought back branches and built themselves temporary shelters on their own roofs, in their courtyards, in the courts of the house of God, and in the square by the water gate and the one by the gate of Ephraim. The whole company that had returned from exile built temporary shelters and lived in them. From the days of Joshua, son of Nun, until that day, the Israelites had not celebrated it like this, and their joy was very great. Day after day, from the first day to the last, Ezra read from the book of the law of God. They celebrated the festival for 7 days, and on the eighth day, in accordance with the regulation, there was an assembly. On the 24th day of the same month, the Israelites gathered together, fasting and wearing sackcloth and putting dust on their heads. Those of Israelite descent had separated themselves from all foreigners. They stood in their places and confessed their sins and the sins of their ancestors. They stood where they were and read from the book of the law of the God, the Lord their God, for a quarter of the day, and spent another quarter in confession and in worshipping the Lord their God. Standing on the stairs of the Levites were Jeshua, Bani, Kadmiel, Shebaniah, Bunai, Sherebiah, Bani, and Canani. They cried out with loud voices to the Lord their God, and the Levites, Jeshua, Kadmiel, Bani, Hashabniah, Sherebiah, Hodiah, Shebaniah, and Pethahiah said, Stand up, praise the Lord your God, who is from everlasting to everlasting.
Blessed be your glorious name, and may it be exalted above all blessing and praise. You alone are the Lord. You made the heavens, even the highest heavens and all their starry host, the earth and all that is on it, the seas and all that is in them. You give life to everything, and the multitudes of heaven worship you. You are the Lord God, who chose Abram and brought him out of Ur of the Chaldeans and named him Abraham. You found his heart faithful to you, and you made a covenant with him to give to his descendants the land of the Canaanites, Hittites, Amorites, Perizzites, Jebusites, and Girgashites. You've kept your promise because you are righteous. You saw the suffering of our ancestors in Egypt. You heard their cry at the Red Sea. You sent signs and wonders against Pharaoh against all his officials and the people of his land, for you knew how arrogantly the Egyptians treated them. You made a name for yourself, which remains to this day. You divided the sea before them so that they passed through it on dry ground, but you hurled their pursuers into the depths, like a stone into mighty waters. By day you led them with a pillar of cloud, and by night with a pillar of fire to give them light on the way they were to take. You came down on Mount Sinai. You spoke to them from heaven. You gave them regulations and laws that are just and right, and decrees and commands that are good. You made known to them your holy Sabbath and gave them commands, decrees and laws through your servant Moses. In their hunger you gave them bread from heaven, and in their thirst you brought them water from the rock. You told them to go in and take possession of the land you had sworn with uplifted hand to give them. But they, our ancestors, became arrogant and stiff-necked, and they did not obey your commands. They refused to listen and failed to remember the miracles you performed among them. They became stiff-necked and in their rebellion appointed a leader in order to return to their slavery. But you are a forgiving God, gracious and compassionate, slow to anger and abounding in love. Therefore you did not desert them, even when they cast for themselves an image of a calf and said, "This is your God who brought you up out of Egypt," or when they committed awful blasphemies. Because of your great compassion, you did not abandon them in the wilderness. By day, the pillar of cloud did not fail to guide them on their path, nor the pillar of fire by night to shine on the way they were to take. You gave your good spirit to instruct them. You did not withhold your manna from their mouths, and you gave them water for their thirst. For 40 years you sustained them in the wilderness. They lacked nothing. Their clothes did not wear out, nor did their feet become swollen. You gave them kingdoms and nations, allotting to them even the remotest frontiers. They took over the country of Sihon, king of Heshbon, and the country of Og, king of Bashan. You made their children as numerous as the stars in the sky, and you brought them into the land that you told their parents to enter and possess. Their children went in and took possession of the land. You subdued before them the Canaanites who lived in the land. You gave the Canaanites into their hands, along with their kings and the peoples of the land, to deal with them as they pleased. They captured fortified cities and fertile land, and took possession of houses filled with all kinds of good things, wells already dug, vineyards, olive groves, and fruit trees in abundance. They ate to the full and were well nourished. They revelled in your great goodness, but they were disobedient and rebelled against you. They turned their backs on your law. They killed your prophets, who had warned them, in order to turn them back to you. They committed awful blasphemies. So you delivered them into the hands of their enemies, who oppressed them. But when they were oppressed, they cried out to you. From heaven you heard them, and in your great compassion you gave them deliverers who rescued them from the hand of their enemies. But as soon as they were at rest, they again did what was evil in your sight. Then you abandoned them to the hand of their enemies, so that they ruled over them. And when they cried out to you again, you heard from heaven, and in your compassion you delivered them time after time. You warned them in order to turn them back to your law, but they became arrogant and disobeyed your commands. They sinned against your ordinances, of which you said, "The person who obeys them will live by them." Stubbornly they turned their backs on you, became stiff-necked and refused to listen. For many years you were patient with them. By your spirit you warned them through your prophets, yet they paid no attention. So you gave them into the hands of the neighbouring peoples. But in your great mercy you did not put an end to them or abandon them, for you are a gracious and merciful God. Now therefore, our God, the great God, mighty and awesome, who keeps his covenant of love, do not let all this hardship seem trifling in your eyes, the hardship that has come on us, on our kings and leaders, on our priests and prophets, on our ancestors, and all your people from the days of the kings of Assyria until today. In all that has happened to us, You have remained righteous, you have acted faithfully, while we acted wickedly. Our kings, our leaders, our priests and our ancestors did not follow your law. They did not pay attention to your commands or the statutes you warned them to keep. Even while they were in their kingdom, enjoying your great goodness to them in the spacious and fertile land you gave them, they did not serve you or turn from their evil ways. But see, we are slaves today, slaves in the land you gave our ancestors, so they could eat its fruit and the other good things it produces. Because of our sins, its abundant harvest goes to the kings you have placed over us. They rule over our bodies and our cattle as they please. We are in great distress.
In view of all this, we are making a binding agreement, putting it in writing, and our leaders, our Levites, and our priests.
Well, it's great kind of having gone through this whole series on Nehemiah, and thanks, Kim, for your prayer. We really look forward to just again God speaking to us through our talk this morning. But more importantly, I think as we have journeyed through this book, our desire is that we are a Bible literate church. That actually we are a church that when we handle the Word of God, we handle it really, really appropriately. And the reason why we've again gone through this is a sense of God telling us to, but also a sense of really wanting to educate ourselves so we know about the book. So I hope you've become familiar with the book of Nehemiah. And as we have gone through it, I hope and pray that you have learned through it. But I want to encourage you again to just pick up the book again and just read through it. We're not going to be doing the last, I think there's about four chapters left, but we're not going to be going through that because now we are going into our summer program. So as from next week, we're going to be meeting together at Chesswood. So we're going to be seeing you. I'm not going to be just talking to a camera. I'm going to be talking to you, you know, and seeing you face to face, and really, really look forward to that. So as we come to the end of the series on Nehemiah, we want to remind ourselves the importance of listening and taking on board what God has said. The American educator and businessman Stephen Covey said, "Most people do not listen with the intent to understand. They listen with the intent to reply." Now, I will put my hand up and say sometimes I have fallen into that trap where I am not listening to somebody because I want to understand what they are saying. I'm simply listening with the intent to reply them and just answer them back. Throughout the Old Testament and also in the New Testament, we are constantly reminded of the important role of God's Word and why we need to listen to it and also obey it. Isaiah the prophet talked about the people who have failed to listen and see what God was doing. So in Isaiah 42 and verse 20, he said this, "You see and recognize what is right, but refuse to act on it. You hear with your ears, but you don't really listen." Jeremiah the prophet spoke about the coming judgment on Israel. And one of the recurring themes within the book of Jeremiah is he spoke about how the people fails to listen and the consequences of not listening. So in Jeremiah 6 and verse 10, it says, "To whom can I give warning? Who will listen when I speak? Their ears are closed and they cannot hear. They scorn the word of the Lord. They don't want to listen at all." In Jeremiah 29, and verse 17 to 21, it says this, "This is what the Lord of heaven armies says. I send war, famine, and disease upon them, and make them like bad figs, too rotten to eat. Yes, I will pursue them with war, famine, and disease, and I will scatter them among the world. I will scatter them around the world. In every nation where I send them, I will make them an object of damnation, horror, contempt, and mockery. For they refused to listen to me. Though I have spoken to them repeatedly through the prophets I sent, and you who are in exile have not listened either, says the Lord. Therefore, listen to this message from the Lord to all you captives here in Babylon. This is what the Lord of heaven armies, the God of Israel, say about your prophet, Ahab, son of Kolaiah, Zedekiah, son of Manasseh, who are telling you lies in my name. I will turn them over to Nebuchadnezzar for execution before your eyes. God was saying that there were prophets who were lying, who were not allowing the people to listen, and because of that, God was going to bring a big punishment upon the people. There is an important role in listening to God, and as we start coming to the end of our study in Nehemiah, I want to focus this morning on actually why it is vital for us to listen to God's word. We are commanded all the time through scripture to engage and respond to God's word. And now that the work of the rebuilding of the wall had come to an end, the people wanted to make sure that history wasn't going to repeat itself again in their lifetime. They wanted to engage with God's word, and they wanted to engage with God and his word. And now we saw the effect of God's word upon them. As the people gathered together to listen to God's word, to make sure that they didn't fall into the trap of all of their ancestors, as we read through chapter 8 and 9, we begin to see how the word of God begins to have an impact upon them. The first thing that we see is that as the people gathered together to listen to the word of God being read, it said the people were moved to tears. I don't know about you. I don't know if you've ever sat down and read through God's word and you were just absolutely awestruck by what you have read. Either you've read something that has really touched your heart about God's love for you, or you have read something that has challenged you to the core, and actually it had brought you to tears. In chapter 8 and verse 9, we are told this. Then Nehemiah, the governor, Ezra, the priest and scribe, and the Levites who were interpreting for the people said to them, "Don't mourn or weep on such a day as this, for today is a sacred day before the Lord." For all the people had been weeping as they listened to the words of the law. There is something powerful about God's word. And God's word is meant to be read not as an academic, book. It's meant to read in a way that actually it touches our heart, because it is almost like a love letter from God, an instruction manual of how to live our life. And when we engage with that word, it has the ability to strike our hearts in such a way that it moves us to tears, or it moves us to sorrow, or it moves us to action. The other thing that we see is that as the people read the word, they then began to understand the real privilege of having God's word. You see, the people of Israel lived at a time when the surrounding nations around them had nothing to do with God. They did not have the word of God. God hadn't shared his word with them. And they began to understand, actually, they were a privileged people because they had God's word available to them. And in verse 10, we are told this. And Nehemiah continued, "Go and celebrate with a feast of rich food and sweet drink, and share gifts of food with people who have nothing prepared. This is a sacred day before our God. Don't be dejected and sad, for the joy of the Lord is our strength." There is something amazing about being recipients of God's word. When we have got the word of God available to us, it gives us an advantage over every other people. And at this point, Nehemiah was saying to the people, actually, you are privileged. Celebrate, rejoice. The joy of the Lord is your strength. You have got God's spoken word to you. Actually, use that word, and use that word very, very effectively. But as I read through these two chapters, what struck me was I began asking myself, how do we handle God's word? How do we today learn to make sure that we handle God's word? Because sadly, what got Israel into all the mess that they found themselves in is that they did not handle the word of God correctly. They became familiar with the word of God, and rather than allowing the word of God to shape them, they wanted to shape God's word. And that danger still remains today. We are meant to allow the word of God to shape us, not the other way around. So many people today want to take God's word and twist it and shape it to say what they want to say, rather than just allowing the word of God to impact them, to hear it, and to allow the truth of that word to shape their life. So, how do we make sure that we do not fall into the same trap? What can we learn from these men and women who were returning to God's grace after they had experienced the power of God's correction? Well, here are three things we can do to handle God's word and handle God's word really, really effectively. Number one, I think we need to get into the habit of studying God's word to understand it. Sometimes we just think, oh, all I need to do is just read the word. But actually, there's a difference in reading something and studying something to make sure that actually we get the heart of what God is saying. So we are told this in verse 13 and 14 of chapter 8. It said, on October 9, the family leaders of all the people, together with the priests and Levites, met with Ezra, the scribe, to go over the law in greater detail. You see, this time they were not just hearing or reading the word, they were going over it in greater detail. They were studying it, interacting with the word. It said, as they studied the law, they discovered that the Lord had commanded through Moses that the Israelites should live in shelters during the festival to be held that month. As they studied the word of God, they suddenly began to understand how that word spoke to them. And that is the beauty and the importance of studying God's word. We can see God's word at a surface level. We just read it. But as we go deeper and we study it, we then begin to get the heart of what God is saying to us. The writer, James, in the New Testament, encouraged the followers of Jesus Christ to experience blessing by engaging with God's word through serious study. You do this by looking at God's word carefully. It says, if you look into the perfect law that sets you free. Basically, James was saying you need to not just glance over God's word, but look at it carefully. And then he says, do what it says. You see, God's word is best experienced when we act upon it. And then he says, don't forget it. There is a real spiritual battle when it comes to God's word. It's like what happens when you take out an interest-free loan. But the lender says, if you do not pay by this date, the interest will jump right up. You know, and most likely the lender wants you to forget. Because if you forget, then it means the moment you go past a certain date, they just lumber you with a great interest. But if you're somebody who takes out a loan like that, what you do is you make sure you don't forget. You get your timing right. And before that interest-free loan is finished, you've paid it off, you've done the right thing, and you've moved on. But if you forget, you can find yourself in serious trouble. And the same thing is with God's word. If we forget what the word of God says, we can find ourselves believing things that damages our life. That is why James put it like this. It says, if you look carefully into the perfect law that sets you free, and if you do what it says and don't forget what you heard, then God will bless you for doing it. That is where serious study comes in. We carefully look at God's word, we do what it says, and we make sure we do not forget it. So the first thing that we need to do in handling God's word correctly is that we need to study it to understand what it is saying to us. And the second thing we need to do is we need to study it to live right with God. Study to live right with God. So there's an understanding that we get, because that understanding needs to lead to an action. In Nehemiah chapter 9, we are told this. On October 31st, the people assembled again, and this time they fasted and they dressed in burlap and they sprinkled dust on their heads. Those of Israelite descent separated themselves from all the foreigners as they confessed their own sin and the sins of their ancestor. They remained standing in place for 3 hours while the book of the law of the Lord their God was read out aloud to them. Then for 3 more hours, they confessed their sins and worshiped the Lord their God. The writer of Hebrews tells us that when we engage with God's word, we find out certain things about it. It is alive. It is powerful. It is sharp like a well-made sword. It cuts through all of our pretense, our sins, and our fear. And it also acts as a mirror that shows us who we really are. You see, one of the powerful things about God's word is that it shines a light on our lives. And it tells us the right thing to do. You might think, well, no, I'm an okay person, you know, and I am a good person. But as you engage with God's word, it gets into you and reveals the condition of your heart. That is why it said these people, they listened to God's word for 3 hours, standing up. We don't do that. You know, we might listen to God's word for about 20, 25 minutes, but for 3 hours, and then 3 hours more, they stood there, and what they did was they confessed their sins and the sins of their ancestors, their father, because they've allowed the word of God to speak into their lives so that they can put themselves right with God. The writer of Hebrews puts it like this. He said, "For the word of God is alive and powerful. It is sharper than the sharpest two-edged sword, cutting between souls and spirits, between joint and marrow. It exposes our innermost thoughts and desires." Anyone who wants to live right will need to study God's word to be able to live right with God. They need to engage with the word, and that word exposes us, cleans us, to allow us to be able to live right with God. And the last thing that we need to do to be able to handle God's word properly is that we need to study it to fuel praise and worship within our lives. It says this, you know, in chapter 9 and from verse 5 onward. It says, then the leaders of the Levites, Jeshua, Kadmiel, Bani, Hashabaniah, Sheribiah, Hodiah, Shebaniah, and Pethaniah called to all the people, "Stand up and praise the Lord your God, for he lives from everlasting to everlasting." Then they prayed, "May your glorious name be praised. May it be exalted above all blessing and praise. You alone are the Lord. You made the skies and the heavens and all the stars. You made the earth and the sea and everything in it. You preserve them all, and the angels of heaven worship you. You are the Lord God who chose Abraham and brought him from all of the shadowlands and renamed him Abraham. When he had proved himself right, you made him a covenant with him to give him and his descendants the line of the Canaanites, Hittites, Amorites, Perizzites, Jebusites, and Girgashites. And you have done what you promised, for you are always true to your word. You saw the misery of your ancestor in Egypt, and you heard their cries from beside the Red Sea. You displayed miraculous signs and wonders against Pharaoh, his official, and all his people, for you knew how arrogantly they were treating our ancestors. You have a glorious reputation that has never been forgotten. You divided the sea for your people so they could walk through on dry land. And when you hauled your enemies into the depth of the sea, they sank like stone beneath the mighty sea. You led our ancestor by a pillar of cloud during the day and a pillar of fire at night so they could find their way." You see, the reason why they were writing all of this was the people of Israel wanted them to understand that the God they were serving and the God they were following was the God of history. He wasn't just a God appearing to them now, but this was the God of their ancestors. He was the one who had shaped their story, their life, their nation, and everything that they were about. I think there is a great danger we face today, and it is the danger of worshipping a false God. Some people don't want God to be sentimental or emotional. They want God to be serious and into classical music, not heavy metal, rock, or blues and jazz. But the truth is, God is more concerned about content than style of music. It is we human beings who want to fit God into a straitjacket with style of music. But what we should be more consumed with is, do our music reflect God's truth and God's nature? Does it adequately speak of who God is truthfully? When we know who God is and we see what God has done through history, and we read the scripture, because actually Christianity, we are not just like, it's not just about the figment of our imagination. We are people of the book. We read the Bible and we get the history. Our history as Christians come from Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, moving into the nation of Israel, moving into the apostles and what Jesus Christ did through them. When we look at all of that and what God has done in history and what God is doing now, those are the things that fuel our praise. Those are the things we thank God about. Not just the fact that Jesus died 2,000 years ago, but actually the impact of that has changed our culture, has shaped our life, and continues to do even more than that. The psalmist wrote, "I will praise the Lord at all times. I will constantly speak his praise." You cannot praise someone you do not know. You might end up saying things about them that are not true. You see, the reason why we study the Word of God is we study the Word of God to be able to know who God is, so we can actually praise the God of heaven truthfully. And as you read through scripture, you find that those who praised God, like David and Shadrach and Meshach and Abraham, they were praising the God that they knew. Not just a figment of their imagination, but the God who they truly knew within their hearts. Those three things are some of the reasons why we need to study the Word of God. It fuels our praise and worship. It enables us to live right. And it gives us great understanding of who we are. And when we get hold of that, they are the things that continually shape our life. So why is listening so important? And why did Nehemiah, Ezra the priest, and all of the Levites and other people gather to listen and apply God's word after the work had been done? The writer James gives us another indication when he said this. He said, "Understand this, my dear brothers and sisters. You must all be quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to become angry." The Word of God has the power to affect our life in such a way that if we're quick to listen to it and we're slow to speak, then it stops us also from being angry. Some of the wars that we find, you know, around the world is because people actually do the opposite. We are slow to listen, we are quick to speak, and we're quick to get angry. And we end up actually getting irated with one another. Sometimes, when I find myself really, really narky or irritated or frustrated with people around me, I find that sometimes it is simply because actually I have stopped listening. I've become distant from my relationship with God and also distant from the people around me. When I don't listen to what people around me are saying or listen to what God is saying, I actually find that I get angry so easily. I met with somebody over the weekend on Friday, and when I was speaking to them, they said God had told them recently to watch their anger, and they had had prayers for that anger. And they said immediately after they had prayers, they had two incidents that happened to them where they were in a public place. They were in a shop and things happened that would have immediately got them angry. But because they had listened to God and had the instruction God's given to them, they were able to navigate that and do something completely different. And they said they came out of it more peaceful, more alive, because rather than getting angry, they had allowed God to walk through their hearts. So let me conclude with this. Let me just give you a couple of things that shows us the reason why listening is really, really important. Listening to God is important. Listening to friends and family around us is important. Even listening to ourselves, slowing down and listening to ourselves is really, really vital for us to be able to do the things and live the life that God wants us to do. As we look at the history of God's people, we have found that those who listened to God made a difference. Those who chose to ignore God's word shipwrecked their life. So here are some things that listening does. And actually, if we apply them to our life, we will see they will make an impact within our life. Number one, listening builds trust. It is only as we respond to what God says that we realize that God is trustworthy. When you listen to what God says and you respond to it, you suddenly realize that God is worth trusting. Listening builds trust. Listening deepens friendship. Abraham was called a friend of God because he listened to what God said, and God appreciated Abraham's devotion and friendship, and God reciprocated that. God said of Abraham, "Can I go and destroy, you know, a city around where Abraham was living without speaking to my friend Abraham?" In our normal everyday life, the people who listen to us and who we listen to, we find that we have a deeper relationship with those people. Listening eliminates misunderstanding. When Jesus appeared on the scene, the religious leaders around that time found him intimidating because Jesus, out of his relationship with the Father, had a completely different narrative about God than the rulers of the day. You see, most people thought that God was angry with them, but actually Jesus Christ came in and he used the term Abba. God is Abba. He is Father. And actually, listening to what Jesus Christ said created, you know, a different understanding, a different narrative about who God was, and brought people to a better place in their relationship with God. Listening takes us to unknown places. "Come and follow me, and I will make you fishers of men." That is what Jesus Christ said to these ordinary men and women who were walking in Palestine around this time. The disciples of Jesus Christ did not know that listening and following Jesus was going to take them to places they never dreamt of. They would have never dreamt that 2,000 years after they had died, and ceased to exist, the people will still be remembering the things that they did with Jesus Christ. Because actually, when we listen to God, God takes us to unknown places, amazing places, actually things that we cannot fathom out. When we listen to God, miracles takes place. Listening also eliminates conflicts. Whenever Paul encountered conflict in the church, one of the things he always did was he wrote to bring clarity into that situation and challenge people with the truth. As people listened to that truth, it led them away from conflict and more into fellowship. And when we listen to God's truth, actually what it does, it has the power to break conflict that exists. Within the church, there has been so many different conflicts that actually as people have stopped and listened and looked at what God said, actually what they have found is that conflict, they have been able to deal with it. Listening also encourages empathy. The Bible says in Proverbs chapter 11 and verse 14, without wise leadership, a nation falls. There is safety in having many advisors. When we listen to what people are going through and we kind of give ears, then we can develop a better empathy to understand what different people are going through and come up with a more rounded and better situation. That is why sometimes when you put a group together and that group are just only men and men are listening to each other, sometimes all you need to do is bring a woman into that group and she says something and all of the men look at each other thinking, oh, we would have never understood that. And actually, sometimes just listening to different people really, really increase our ability to empathize with people. That is why even in society today, when they want to put a group together, they bring people who have had different experiences so people are able to understand where other people are coming from. And lastly, let me just say this, listening increases productivity. If you want to produce more and grow, you need to learn to listen. And that is a lesson that all of us needs to learn from. I love the story in John chapter 4 when Jesus encounters the Samaritan woman. We are told that Jesus Christ had to. He had to go through Samaria. Now we know Jesus could have gone so many other ways, but he was led by the Holy Spirit to go to Samaria. And when he got there, he got involved in a conversation with a woman. Jesus listened to her and she listened to him. They had an interaction together. But the amazing thing is that interaction meant the whole community got saved. Jesus used minimum effort to achieve maximum gain simply because he listened to the woman. He spoke to her, they engaged with one another, and Jesus was able to lead her to a place where she recognized he was the Messiah. And she went back, got everybody from her village, and come and listen to this man who told me everything about me. They listened to her, and they all came back, listened to Jesus Christ. And then they said, actually, we don't believe because of what you have said. We believe because we have heard him ourselves. And all that took place was everybody listened to one another, and there was great productivity. The writer of Revelation repeatedly said to the seven churches in Asia, and what he said to them is a great warning for us today, because those churches in history ceased to exist because they did not do what the writer of Revelation, what God's Holy Spirit consistently said to every single one of that church. And this is what the Holy Spirit said to them. It said, let him who has ears hear what the Spirit of God is saying to his church. Let him who has ears hear what the Spirit of God is saying to his church. If you want to have a faith that is dynamic, that is alive, that makes a difference to those who you come into contact with, and I will say all of us, we need to learn to listen to God, read God's word, hear what God is saying to us, and then respond to God's word. Apply those words to our lives, apply them to the situation we find ourselves in, and we will release a power that actually this world do not know. I pray that God will give us ears to hear what he wants us to hear during this season. Let's pray together. Father, we thank you for your word this morning, and thank you for the joy of being able to look through your book. We pray that you will continue, Lord God, to speak to us, you know, and now and in the future through the book of Nehemiah. We want to grow in that book. We want to grow in the truth that is contained in that. And we pray that you will continue to speak to us. So, Father, we pray that as we journey into another week, you will give us ears to hear what your Holy Spirit is saying to us. Guide us, you know, and open our hearts and open our ears. You know, and Lord, I pray you will teach us, Lord God, the art of listening so that actually we can respond to you and respond to those around us. Do this, we pray, Father, in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Let's get back now into a time of worship together, and then Kim will come and wrap up our service for us. Thank you.
I've searched the world, but it couldn't fill me. Man's empty praise and treasures of fate are never enough. Then you came along and put me back together.
Okay, so obviously every week we have suggested Bible reading plans for you from YouVersion. And I know from today there's probably a lot, you know, to take in, lots of things that we've heard and perhaps things we want to ponder. But as I say, we do have these reading plans, and one of the suggested ones for this coming week is one called Broken Crayons, Still Colour. And I'd like, if I may, just to take the time to read from the first day's devotional and then do the prayer that's at the end of that, because I thought it was really quite poignant and apt to, you know, to go along with our talk today. So in this devotional, which is called Broken Crayons, Still Colour, the writer talks about visiting her nieces and colouring in pictures with them. And she says, when we opened the container of crayons, a burst of colours greeted us. These were well-worn crayons that had been used for colour dozens of pictures. I chose a broken and worn-out green crayon. In our throwaway society, it would be easy to think that the work of this crayon was done, that it needed to be replaced with a brand new crayon instead. However, as I began to colour with this broken, worn-out crayon, my nieces looked at me and told me my colouring page was beautiful, because you see, broken crayons still colour. Just like that broken, worn-out crayon, we can also feel useless to God because of the mistakes we've made, all the things that have been done to us. We feel broken and ugly and useless. We think God would rather have someone else to do his work, someone with less brokenness and baggage, someone who has it all together. The truth is, we all have brokenness in our lives. Many times we can compare our blooper reel to someone else's highlight reel. The truth is, no one has a perfect life. And just like the broken crayon, God is always able to use our brokenness to create something beautiful, a masterpiece. Many times what we see as our biggest mistakes and failures can become what God uses the most. However, the enemy in our minds often tells us we are worthless and no longer useful for God's kingdom. Little do we know that God is using our brokenness to create something more beautiful than we could ever imagine. So just finish in prayer. Lord, we just thank you that you never waste anything that's happened in our lives. We thank you that you can turn our brokenness into something beautiful, even when we cannot see it. Help us to open our hearts to you and allow you to bring healing and freedom. We love you. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Well, thank you so much for joining us today. I hope you really enjoyed our service. Again, thank you to all of those that have been involved and all of those behind the scenes. I want to say a big thank you for everyone involved in the wedding yesterday as well. A lot of hard work went into that. And as I say, bride and groom were just gorgeous. We look forward to the prayer meeting on Tuesday for you to join us for that. And then obviously next Sunday, 1st of August, 10 o'clock, we'll see you hopefully at Chestwood Middle School if you're able to come. All right, have a really good week. Lots of love. God loves you. Take care.
Time to make a change, revolution day, put it into action, and live.